We all love the Lowcountry lifestyle, which is why we should do our best to protect it. To get insurance that helps you protect your home from whatever the Lowcountry throws at you, contact CT Lowndes & Company today. Their local agents can review your coverage to help make sure you're properly protected. CT Lowndes & Company has been helping protect and insuring the Lowcountry since 1850. Visit ctlowndes.com to learn more and request a quote. That's ctlowndes.com.
Okay, round two. Name something that's not boring.
A laundry? Ooh, a book club. Computer solitaire, huh?
Ah, oh, sorry. We were looking for Chumba Casino. That's right. Chumbacasino.com has over 100 casino-style games. Join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes. Chumbacasino.com. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Okay, so come on, like best song ever?
Maybe by the best band ever. I will say Another One Bites the Dust. You must really hate the Patriots. Another One Bites the Dust by Queen is appropriate after just watching the Super Bowl.
Yes, definitely, because we all wanted the Patriots to lose, right?
Except for me, as we talked about on the last podcast, I was really rooting for these Patriots to win mainly because it pissed off everyone. And I like it when everyone is a little aggravated and kind of makes me happy.
With that being said, I'm Chris Donovan, and this is We Should Be Better at This. What's your name again?
My name is Eric Leckie, at least last time I checked my underwear.
Awesome. You don't just have the initials EL?
Oh, my God. Look at this. You're helping me be more efficient.
Well, we were correct on the last podcast. We did say that either way, Philly is burning down.
Yes. not only should Philly be better at this, we should be better at this. And this is episode 10. Philly people got climbing greased light poles and burning things down and causing a general ruckus. I got to say, Philly, ruckus. Act like you've been there before. Oh, wait, that's right. You never are there. Ever.
Nope, never been there before, but now they have their ring. They have as many rings as the Seattle Seahawks now, so I'm not going to hate on too much. But I am glad that Brady did lose. Now it's going to be a big controversy whether or not Belichick's going to retire. I guess the defensive coordinator was supposed to go and be the head coach of the Colts, but then turned it down yesterday.
Yeah, that was a pretty big news. I mean, that was a shock. It came out of left field. And I think the only way he's staying with the Patriots is if the ownership came to him and said, listen, this is Belichick's last year. We want you waiting in the wings. This is your team to take over. And
here's a $1 million bonus. Please stay.
Exactly.
That's what happened.
I'm sure that helped, too. Also, you know, the owner in Indy, Jim Irsay, the owner, he's known to be a little wackadoo and he's kind of an asshole. And so I think that maybe that kind of played into it where he was like, you know, why don't I just stay here where I know what's how things are. And I think he's going to be taking over from Belichick. Here.
Wackadoo.
You can go ahead and add that. Ruckus. We should be better at this glossary.
Pretty sure those words don't exist. Okay.
Well, it was a fantastic Super Bowl. I want to know your thoughts on a couple specific things. Number one, was that Clement, I think is his name, TD catch in the back of the end zone a catch? It sure looked to me like he was bobbling it. And then he stepped out of bounds. It just with all this whole what is a catch, what isn't a catch, that one looked like one that they would have overruled other points of the season.
Yeah, no, I think the referees stepped back a little bit and allowed the players to actually play a little bit more, not trying to change the course of the game with the penalties. So I think leaving that as is, it was a catch, it was a touchdown. I think that was a good call on their part. And, you know, again, it is a Super Bowl last game of the year, supposed to be the best two teams in the league. It's a giant spectacle for the United States and their TV world. So letting them play and not throwing flags in certain calls like that, I think was a good choice.
Well, okay, and I agree with you for the most part, because I think in championship games, you want to let the two teams fight it out, right?
Yes.
Like you don't want that's how it is, especially in Major League Baseball, where an umpire like can call balls or strikes differently or tighten up. You really want them to kind of call things a little bit lighter of a touch, right? I think we'll all agree on that. However, when it comes to the catch rule in particular, there has been so much ever since Calvin Johnson in the end zone set the football down and they ruled it not a catch, which I think that was the precipice of when all this went downhill. So I think ever since that moment, they're constantly redefining what a catch is and isn't. And we saw, I mean, that Pittsburgh touchdown from Jesse James Which, I mean, man, ever since he divorced Sandra Bullock, he's really beefed up and gotten pretty strong. But
remember, he was dating porn stars before Sandra Bullock.
This is true. But Jesse James, this other Jesse James, that to me was a touchdown all 7 days of the week, and they ruled that not a touchdown. And in this one, it looks like the ball's moving around in his arm, and then his second foot comes out of bounds. I just don't like that it's not consistent. That's what bothers me.
I'm 100% sure that rule will be one of the few that are changed in the offseason this year to accommodate any misunderstanding of it, or just basically maybe elaborate on the verbiage, because you're right, that could have been or might not have been a catch because of all this controversy. But again, it was allowing them to play, and they were able to, I don't know, it was just a good game all the way around.
You know, we talked about doing a segment called Let's Fix This, where we take a segment or a topic and we fix something with our unique tongue-in-cheek way.
Because we're amazing people and know everything about everything.
Pretty much. That's actually the summary. It's a really good summary. I would say that in this particular case, if we were playing a game of Let's Fix This, how about this for a catch? Let's just ask a room full of 8-year-olds, 8 to 10-year-olds.
Okay.
Just – hey, listen, did he – you show a quick replay to a group full of 8 to 10-year-olds, maybe like 10 of them, so you get a good, nice round thing. And you go, listen, did he catch that ball? And if they say, yeah, that's a catch, then it's done. It's settled. And I think it's almost like when we go to replay review, we can go to preschool review. Or yep. We could go to like a second grade review. Like the coach, instead of throwing a red flag to challenge, he throws like a rainbow-colored flag.
A stuffed animal. They throw a stuffed animal.
Yeah, you throw a stuffed animal on the field, and you're saying, I'm challenging it. I want a bunch of 6-year-olds or whatever to decide if that play was legit or not. Because honestly, my 6-year-old at home who knows nothing about football, she's more of a baseball girl, but she watches the games with me every once in a while. She'll look at something and say, what happened? And I'll say, well, they said he didn't catch that. She'll go, no, he caught it. It's like, yes, exactly. We need the simplicity of a 6-year-old to just clarify this for all the stupid adults that have ruined it.
Will they be tapping into a different audience? I think it's an amazing idea. They can expand their demographics of football to little kids that don't care about anything except watching a bunch of other little kids change the course of history in an NFL game.
Yeah, ESPN Junior. All the games will be turned into cartoons. But that was a big one. The other one I thought was interesting storyline. Brady was magnificent. He threw for 500 yards, broke a bunch of Super Bowl records. They had no punts, no interceptions. He had 500 yards. They ran the ball for over 120 yards, and they lost.
Yeah, no, it was amazing. It was the most yards put up by a quarterback in an NFL in Super Bowl history, and the most points ever put up in an NFL game. The most yards between the two teams was like over 1,100 yards or something total. And it broke the record for Super Bowl, broke the record for pro season and for regular season. The most yards ever put up by two teams.
Yeah, that's insane. The other thing I thought that everyone's kind of buzzing about after the Super Bowl, besides obviously the win and all that, is
the weed
the TV.
And all the cocaine they were doing.
Yes, all of that.
It was Philly.
I mean, God, that whole town's just such a mess. I would say the TV commercials were kind of another big topic, especially the GMC Martin Luther King ad, which could you – we've talked about ads on this before, about how ads got approved, how the hell could this ad get approved kind of a thing. And you know, if I'm in the executive offices over there at GMC and someone ran this ad by me, I would say, you know, I get it. We all love Martin Luther King. Do you maybe want to re-look at this one a little bit and see if this is coming off good? Because I have never seen a commercial turn pretty much everyone off. Right, left, black, white.
Well, I'm Republican, pretty sure Democrat. MLK's dream wasn't to buy a GMC truck. So I think that's the whole idea behind that. I mean, I agree with you. I didn't get to see it actually during the game. I saw it after with the whole controversy. So I probably wouldn't have noticed it at all during the game. I probably wouldn't have been paying attention much because it was a commercial for one, and two, I was drinking. but no, I agree with you. I think that they should have thought that one through a little bit harder than just allowing that to go to the game.
I just felt in poor taste. And you're right. Like GMC trucks. Yeah. When I think of Martin Luther King, I think of a big off-roading truck adventure. The other one that was just like, there was another one, I can't even remember, I think it was for T-Mobile, and it was another one of these ads where it's a bunch of nothing, and you could start to see these a lot, and it's really pissing me off, is you see these ads where it's a bunch of things that have nothing to do with the product, it's to get them socially noticed, mm-hmm. and then it's, by the way, buy T-Mobile. And, you know, there was an ad that had a bunch of the babies. They're all of different races. They gave you a speech about how we all love each other or whatever. You know what? Bullshit, T-Mobile. I know you don't love me because if you truly love me, if I paid my bill 2 days late, you wouldn't add a $40 late charge. So go screw yourself on that one. It's like, that was stupid.
No, I agree. My favorite commercials are probably the Tide commercials with that guy from Stranger Things.
Very clever.
Where
yeah,
they,
very clever.
They tied in Mr. Clean into it. They tied in Old Spice, where the guy's on the horse doing the whole Old Spice commercial, and then it backs out, and he's sitting on the back of the horse, and he's like, it's a Tide commercial. It's a Tide commercial.
It was also clever because it had you fooled. You think you're watching something else, and they jump in with a Tide commercial, and that's the kind of things that become memorable. People remember that.
That's what's getting them the social hits. That's what they're trying to do, is they're trying to go viral online, which is free advertising if you can pay a bunch of money to get it on like your Super Bowl, and then that one comes out and everybody watches it online. It just doubles and triples your effect of a commercial, really.
Yeah, big time. The other what did you think about I don't know if your family watched it, but did you watch the halftime show at Justin Timberlake?
We did watch the halftime
what
show.
What did your daughter think of it there?
Jalene, the oldest 14-year-old, she was a little bit like, eh, whatever. My youngest one left. She didn't get to see it. She was next door with her friends. My boy didn't really care.
Good man. Good man.
And Evelyn, my wife, really, really enjoyed it. I told her it was an performance.
It really was.
The whole Prince thing was cool, but like dropping a sheet from the ceiling and just projecting him onto the sheet is a little bit lackluster for the fact the budget was really high.
Exactly. I got some insight on that. I actually was just reading a report that the people from Prince's, what do they call it? Like your estate, I guess you would call it. They put the quash on it just about a day before. So as of Saturday, it was going to be an actual hologram on stage performing with Justin Timberlake. And the Prince estate came and said, listen, he was really against this like marketing. You know, he wasn't what you would call a commercial kind of guy. And so they said he would never want something like that at the Super Bowl, which is so commercial. And he wouldn't like that. Well, they were in Minnesota and he had recently died. So they still want to do a tribute to him. So they said, we'll do it via the sheet. So the sheet thing was a last minute, 24 hours before, solution to that problem, which I thought was kind of amazing that they had to last minute do that.
Yeah, considering everybody was talking about it. The Super Bowl's in Minneapolis. Prince died last year. Oh, my God. It's Justin Timberlake. He sings just like him. Why is he going to do tribute? Like, that was the talk of the whole time. And for them to have to do it within 24 hours is just ridiculous. Like, right. Come on. What happened to the producers that did the one with what was it, Deflategate, where Janet Jackson boob came out? Deflategate, is that what it's called?
Nipplegate.
Nipplegate.
Nipplegate. Everything has a gate. I once left the gate open at the house, and my wife called it the gate. It was a little disappointing, but I understand. But, man, 24 hours to kind of make a big change like that. There was a lot of lip sync going on as well, which, you know, I guess is to be expected. I wasn't super impressed with the Timberlake halftime show, but I know how hard those have got to be to put together. I mean, what do you expect?
Yeah, no, exactly. He was running around a lot, so lip syncing, of course, was going to happen. But, I mean, he sang a lot of his number one hits, which was good because that's all people want to hear. I mean, honestly, it's the largest stage for something like this. One of the largest, I should say. So to play a song nobody knows off your new album is very tacky. So he did the right thing by playing a medley of a lot of his number one hits, per se. So, but that's about it for the Super Bowl, right? I mean, it's over. They won. Now let's go to next year. Seahawks, go.
Yeah, I think that's it. It's time to move on to baseball season as far as I'm concerned. I'm already counting down the days.
Yeah, go Supersonics. Woo!
All right, I want to play a new game. Let's play a game called Rank 'em. This is where we rank things first, second, or third. In this particular case, because we're going to do food in this one, but it's first place is you're going to eat it all the time. Second place is you can only eat it once a month. Third place is you either eat it never again or once a year. It could be many things. This particular issue is food. We're going to do the breakfast edition of Rank 'em. So I'm going to give three things. Rank 'em. E-M. Rank 'em.
Rank 'em. Oh, because we're in the now, yo.
We're in the now, yo. We're going to rank three things. This is the breakfast edition. So first up, we're going to rank bacon, sausage, and hash browns. And you got to pick one first, second, and third. First, you're going to eat all – you can eat anytime you want. Second, you can't have more than once a month. And third, you can only have once a year. How do you rank them?
You're screwing with me here. That's like my breakfast of champions right there.
I know.
Throwing some eggs. I have to go bacon number one because bacon is just – I mean – bacon.
You can add it to other things. So you could incorporate bacon into other things, I think, pretty easily.
Yeah, you can wrap it around jalapenos. You can wrap it around hot dogs, bacon double cheeseburger, bacon delicious. Breakfast shots with Jameson. Like, you can put it around everything.
Really? That's right. Okay, so what's second place in? You can only eat it once a month.
This one's tough because sausage and hash browns are like the core of my breakfast and my breakfast burritos. Oh, shit. I'm going to go sausage because I love a good sausage. There's a drop That's, for you.
There it is. I heard that one before. That's for our fans out in West Hollywood.
Yes.
And then so that leaves hash browns you can only eat once a year. That's interesting. All right. So we're going to do another round, breakfast edition.
All right. Are you doing this or no? Just me?
I'm going to do this one. All right. Next one. You do it.
Okay, so the first item or the items we have for the rank 'em, number two is scrambled eggs, omelets, or hard-boiled eggs.
Oh, okay. Well,
it's all eggs though. It's cheating.
Yeah, that's an egg one. Yeah, this is an all egg. All right, I'm gonna do scrambled eggs. Have got to be first. They're very versatile. You know, you could kind of make scrambled eggs into anything. You could mix it with something else very easily. Do a little
it's called
cheese
an omelet.
On top. Yeah, it's essentially called. But I mean, scrambled egg. You could really kind of do anything. Omelet is that like gently folded in thing. I would probably put omelets second. Omelets are a specialty thing I order when I go out to restaurants. Scrambled eggs is something I can make at home all the time.
Yeah.
Hard boiled eggs for me are third. I probably have eaten one round of hard boiled eggs like maybe every other year. So for me, that's pretty easy for me to go first and third. All right, we got one more. All I'm gonna do it for you.
Okay. What do we got?
All right. First one up is cereal. Then we got oatmeal. And then we have everyone's favorite drug of choice, the caffeine that comes with a good, delicious cup of coffee in the morning. So how would you rank those?
First one is I eat it all the time. I would say cereal is probably number one.
Really? What kind? Do you got like a cereal of go-to cereal of choice, or are you kind of a...
Just kind of whatever's left in the cabinet the kids don't eat usually. But I'll eat what the kids eat. I'll have Cocoa Puffs, or I'll have Rice Krispie Treats, or not treats, but Rice Krispies, or Fruity Pebbles, or something like that. I don't eat it all the time.
Rice Krispie Treats.
I don't eat it all the time, but I do eat it more than I would eat oatmeal or drink coffee.
Okay, so cereal's number one. Oatmeal's kind of like for old people. I don't picture oatmeal being a thing that anyone like. You either have to be under the age of 8 or over the age of 80. Those are the only two segments of people that eat oatmeal. That's my hot take on oatmeal.
That's your hot take. Well, it's my number two.
Really? So coffee's going to be a dead last for you?
Yeah, I don't drink coffee very often. If I do, it might be on Saturdays, and it'll have Bailey's in it. So honestly, drinking coffee is not something I usually drink. I usually have a Rockstar or something instead. I'm not a coffee drinker. So yeah, coffee, I could go once a year with coffee.
Well, coffee is more of really just a Bailey's delivery system for you.
100%. And if I'm feeling a little risque, I'll put some whiskey in it.
It's like when people are eating ranch dressing and they're eating like celery with the ranch dressing. The celery is just a scoop. To delivery system for ranch dressing. So that's what the coffee is in this scenario.
Yep, 100%.
Wow. All right. That was actually surprising.
All right, you ranked the last three. You ranked the last three. Cereal, oatmeal, coffee.
Okay. Well, I don't drink coffee, but the smell of coffee is amazing. And when I smell coffee, it means my wife is kind of up and making a cup. And that makes me happy. I'm going to go cereal one. I'm actually going to rank it the same as you because I think – as you said, cereal's kind of versatile. It's a grab and go.
Yeah.
I got 8 minutes, maybe less. I got 5 minutes. All I need is a freaking bowl and a spoon. And half the time, the bowl doesn't even have to be clean.
Exactly.
And so that's how I feel about cereal. And I love simplicity. So that's good for me. And then only because I don't drink coffee, because I'm still 5 years old, I actually drink hot cocoa. I really honestly do. We bought a Keurig coffee maker, and we had to make sure that it could pump out only hot water, no coffee,
yep.
So that I could still make hot cocoa because I'm 5 years old.
That you are.
All right. Well, so funny. After that, let's move on to our movie game.
Oh, hooray for Hollywood. It's really got me. Hooray.
Hooray.
This week's theme for our movie game is called Treasure Hunt Movies.
Ooh.
So, yeah, a good wide little net we can cast here. So to remind everyone of our game, Rotten Tomatoes score, but it's the critic score, which we will say that we commonly disagree with, quite commonly. But still, we're going to try and guess the score. Closest wins. Doesn't matter if you go over. And I'm going to go first. I'm going to pick one for you. This is in 1985. This is a children's classic.
One of my favorite movies of all time.
In order to save their home from foreclosure, a group of misfits sets out to find a pirate's ancient valuable treasure. The movie is The Goonies in 1985. And I will say, is there any way that a movie could be any more 80s than this Goonies movie? I mean, like, think of the movie.
Riding the bikes.
And just think of how 80s this movie is.
Yeah, your parents aren't home. You stay home by yourself. You're riding bikes and just driving by your parents' work. And they're like, oh, hi, don't die. And they just let you go and
total
you do whatever you
freedom.
Want. Yep.
Total freedom. You also got the group of misfits. You got the weird bad guys that for some reason are in this small Oregon town, which is just super weird, right? Like these big bad people. You got the over-the-top bad guys. You got the cheesy set design, which is just so 80s. Lots of slang and lingo in here.
Kids saying bad words.
Yes.
Oh, it's so awesome.
And I didn't know this. You know, I always knew that this was directed by Richard Donner. I had no idea that it was written by Steven Spielberg and Christopher Columbus. And Steven Spielberg didn't want to direct it for some reason. And we recently actually just showed this to my daughters. My oldest one liked it. My youngest one thought it was a little weird. I can understand that, though. She's still six. But I saw this in theaters in 1986 when it came out. Did you?
I did not see it in theaters because I was poor.
Oh, that's right. You guys just had the projector on the sheet in the middle of town. That's right. All right.
No, that was the Prince concert. Come on. Oh. I did not see it in theaters, but my aunt did have the VHS. Beta. I'm pretty sure she had Beta.
Oh, wow. There you go. You just dated yourself.
We watched the hell out of it. And then, of course, when it was on, I think USA or something down the road, we ended up recording it on VHS and had that version of it, which was the edited version. So I'm used to the edited version. So when I see the unedited version, which is just a little bit more cussing and like, I think, a big octopus and then something else, that I like it a lot better. I like this
movie. Now, keep in mind, this is what the critics would say, though. I think you and I would give this a different score than what maybe critics would give.
Three things to say about this movie. Truffle Shuffle, booty traps, and Chester Copperpot.
Or I would have also said, hey, you guys!
Right? 100%. So this one, I don't know how good it did in the theaters. I don't know. I'm going to be conservative. I'm going to say like an 85.
85. Okay. Now next up for you.
All right. Your first one came out in 2004, where a historian races to find the legendary Templar treasure before a team of mercenaries. Now, this has to do with the Masonic Temple, about how our old forefathers were hiding things from the world because of war and the Civil War and all sorts of stuff. And it's called National Treasure with Nicolas Cage. Oh, wait, that was my Keanu Reeves.
Maybe our finest American actor.
Not. That's an 80s reference, too.
Oh, my God. So what did you think of this movie? Did you like this movie?
Yeah, I like these movies.
God. I just want to smack you right now. Because you're the reason that they keep making this bullshit every single time. Listen, I'm all for a good, cheesy, stupid movie. We would call this a popcorn flick, right?
Like yep, one that's
100%. It's 100% a popcorn flick. I think this will be one that is completely separated, where the critics probably hated it and the audience liked it. It's a popcorn flick. Nicolas Cage is a horrible actor. This one wasn't bad. This one wasn't that
bad. He's not a horrible actor. He just makes bold choices.
He makes really bold choices. Yes. This is not a good movie, but it was enjoyable. The sequels were a pile of trash for me, but I thought this one was okay. I'm gonna say that the critics couldn't have liked it too much, but maybe I'm gonna say a 60.
60, okay.
All right, next up for you, I'm gonna try and throw you off because, like I said, I'm competitive. I love winning this game. Next up, there's this movie. It's a pretty legendary movie. It's all the way back in 1948. It's important in movie lore just because of what it meant for movie making at the time. It was considered a landmark film. Fred Dobbs and Bob Curtin are two Americans searching for work in Mexico. They convince an old prospector to help them mine for gold in the Sierra Madre Mountains. The movie is Treasure of the Sierra Madre.
I thought you were talking Toy Story 2.
Oh, no. So this is
Prospector.
The Prospector. So this one has Humphrey Bogart, the absolutely wonderful old man Walter Houston, which has been, ever since he was in this movie, has been a cliche in movie making. They always have the old prospector that goes, gotta go get that gold. You know, I think even the prospector in the Toy Story, funny that you mentioned it, movies, was kind of essentially based on this guy from this movie. I think it's an amazing movie. It's a classic. It's a Humphrey Bogart movie. I'm going to go out on a limb and say you've never seen it.
No, I've seen this. I like it. Really?
You have? Oh, okay,
no,
good.
No, I lied. I haven't seen it at all.
Oh, my God. Okay, yeah. You're killing me here, Smalls. All right. Well, knowing that it's a classic movie and all that, it really is quite good. I highly recommend it. They just had their 100th anniversary, which is what reminded me of it. So my wife and I went out and saw it at the Egyptian Theater here in Hollywood, a famous theater for their 100th anniversary. But what say you? What is your prediction?
I don't even know where to land on this thing because the movie came out 50 years before Rotten Tomatoes was even invented. So then people had to go in and rate it after the fact. So it was probably a classic by then. So it probably got really high ratings, but
look at this. You're like the Columbo of sniffing out scores.
I feel like I'm talking on a game show right now, trying to explain how I'm smarter than a fifth grader. So with that being said, I'm going to say pink. Oh, I'm sorry. That's not, I'm going to say, I don't know. I'm going to say 80.
Oh, sir, I think you blew it. All right, next up, you got one for me.
All right, this one came out in 1999, where an American serving in the French Foreign Legion on an archaeological dig. I can get that word.
There it is. Hey, don't worry. You tripped over it, but you found yourself.
I learned that word by watching Jurassic Park. Archaeological dig in ancient city, accidentally awakening a mummy that wreaks havoc on him and his crew. Starring another U.S. gem actor, Brendan Fraser, and a really hot piece of, I mean, a really beautiful young lady by Rachel, what's her name? Rachel?
Raquel. I think she goes by the Raquel way of pronouncing it. Raquel Wise.
Yes, Wise. Oh, yeah. Anyway.
You know what? She actually might make an appearance on the list actually at some point for
one of
them.
She might. She might actually do that. Okay. So what do you think? This was the first of I want to say three or four, including the Scorpion King spinoff with The Rock. So
and the spinoff with The Rock was kind of The Rock's debut, really, into movies. Not maybe his debut; he made smaller stuff, but that was really like his first starring vehicle. Mm-hmm. And then who would have thought all these years later he would be in every single movie ever made?
Yes, especially about horrible two-dimensional video games like Rampage.
Yes. This mummy obviously had been made many times. The first one, '82, with Boris Karloff, but I think it's been remade like almost every decade because I think there's one in the 40s, the 50s. I don't know about the 60s, but there was one in the 70s. So all we have to do is find one in the 80s, and it's basically been made every decade.
Last year they remade one with Tom Cruise, right?
There you go. See, it's kind of every decade they feel that we need one of these. I remember this movie. I remember seeing it in theaters. I was, I think it came out just when I was out of high school. And I thought it was fun. It was another one that we would describe as a popcorn flick. Brendan Fraser was pretty cast. And the special effects at that time, when you go back and look at it now, it's not as good. But at that time, those were pretty damn good special effects.
Those bugs got me every time, man. Those bugs.
Oh, my God. Those bugs are creepy as hell. Or when the sand comes off, like the way the sand would blow around into different shapes.
Yeah,
apes and all that. That was pretty interesting. I'm going to say that the critics probably thought this one was good, not great. I'm going to go with 65.
I think it would have been lower.
All right. No, though. I can picture. I think all of the ones we chose today, or at least Goonies, National Treasure, and The Mummy, is going to be one where the critics had it low, but the audience had it high. I think the audience might have liked it. So let's see how we did. First up. The Goonies was my pick for you.
Yeah.
You chose an 85. The actual score is a 70. I think I agree with you. I think it's an 85. But the actual score that critics gave it was a 70, which actually isn't bad. Kid movie that we all know is cheesy. So that means the critics were actually kind of like.
Yeah.
Next up, one for you, National Treasure. I think you kind of stumped me on that one because National Treasure, I guess 60. That one came in at a 44. So I think critics really kind of poo-pooed this. That's really bad. But let's face it, we all know it was a shitty movie. It was just enjoyable. Treasure of the Sierra Madre, 1948, a classic. You were on the right track. It sounded like you were talking yourself into the right score. I was trying to trick you on this one. This is one of only, I think, about 12 movies. It's a perfect score. It's 100% on IMDb, and you guessed an 80. You were talking your way into it. I thought you were going to go like 95, 96, and then you back down to 80.
It's at 100? Are you kidding me?
It is at a 100, a perfect score.
That sucks.
It's only about – I think there's about 10 movies that are perfect score, Toy Story being one of them, if Funny that you mentioned that. Finally, The Mummy, I guess 65. The actual score was a 57. But like I said, if you look at all of these, the audience score is way higher. These are movies that people tended to like a lot more than the critics.
Well, you only beat me by 12 points this time.
Pretty close.
No, not close.
You wouldn't talk yourself.
I wouldn't think any show, any movie is 100. There's no such thing as perfect in this world. People are weird.
People are weird. All right. I want to, if you don't mind, I want to go under my skin if I can do so.
Go ahead.
Because I've got you under my skin. Yes, I've got you under my skin.
All right. Time for a little under my skin. It's been a couple weeks since I did this. I took a few weeks off, mainly because it wasn't good for my heart. I was going to have an aneurysm mixed with a heart attack, mixed with a stroke. It would have been horrible. But I'm ready to get back on board with my anger and let my anger flow. Today, my under my skin is focused on grape as a flavoring. First of all, no one wants it. Quit making it, candy makers. No one ever said, hey, glad I got a pack full of purples, which is exactly what it is. It never tastes like actual grape. It tastes like the color purple. Who decided that this taste was going to be the artificial flavor that was chosen for all of human time to represent the color purple and the supposed flavor of grape, as if they've never eaten a freaking grape before? Ever gone to a breakfast restaurant where they were out of grape jelly? No, of course not, because all that's ever left of is this delicious strawberry. It's long gone. All that's left is the freaking grape, because no one chooses it. This isn't just some random flavor. We decided that all things will either taste like disgusting version of cherry. Don't get me started on that artificial flavor. Or it is either cherry or grape. Every freaking cough syrup is this. It's either cherry or grape in every candy and every scent and every cough medicine, whatever. Who is making these decisions? How can we get them to stop? If it's going to taste like a grape, I want it to taste like I freaking chomped into a green grape from the grocery store that I didn't pay for that's called grazing. That's what I hope it tastes like. This artificial purple flavor needs to stop. No one likes it when they get the purples. You know what you do when you open the pack of Shock Tarts and you get a bunch of purples? You set them aside. You eat every other color instead of purple. Quit doing it. Quit insulting the flavor of grape. And quit putting it in my packets of jelly on the table at every breakfast counter. I'm done with you, grape. And that's under my skin.
You'd never know that Eric was a wine drinker.
Yes. All right.
Shall we do the list?
Yeah, let's do the list.
I wonder who wrote the book of life.
All right, so if you haven't heard the end of the show before because, I don't know, you turned it off because we're not that entertaining, well, you've made it this time. And what we do is at the end of each show, we add to our list. And our list is the list that everybody has. I have one. Eric has one. My wife has one. And it's a list of people that you're allowed to cheat on your significant other with, and it's a free pass. Now, my wife, not necessarily the biggest fan of this segment, but I love doing this segment. And I'll do a little recap for you of who has been on our list thus far. On Eric's list, we have Alicia Silverstone, Emma Stone, Christina Ricci, Jennifer Love Hewitt, Kate Upton, Michelle Janicki, Daisy Ridley, and Brooke Burke. On my list, I have Alyssa Milano, Danai Gurira, Scarlett Johansson, Neve Campbell, Shania Twain, Michelle Rodriguez, Danica Patrick, and Halle Berry. Now, I'm going to let Eric choose first because, honestly, this could come down to the fact that if you don't prep for more than one name, your name will get picked.
Absolutely. This is absolutely true. We've had rival names on many an occasion. Absolutely.
So, Eric, I'll let you go first this week on the list.
Alrighty, I appreciate that. Now, I want to actually call out something specific from our list. Besides Alicia Silverstone, I don't have any blondes on my list. Yet my wife is always accusing me of liking blondes.
Well, Michelle Janicki, she's kind of like a dishwater blonde, right?
Yeah, she's kind of – it's like a brownish blonde. But, I mean, really no true blonde. And I think even Alicia Silverstone, she's known for her blonde hair because of the movie Clue.
Yeah.
But I think she's a natural brunette.
Kate Upton also.
So my point is – yeah, okay, there you go. So I'm just saying, come on, wife, quit accusing me of liking blondes only. And today, just to prove her even more wrong, because it's my favorite thing to do.
She doesn't listen to this.
she has a We Should Be Better at This tattoo across her chest. It's amazing.
Does she? Where are the bees landing? Never mind. Just keep going.
I keep going. And I'll let that one sit there. So my pick is the multi-talented. She's an actress. She does music. She's got, I mean, pretty much the definition of the cute girl next door vibe. She is actress Zooey Deschanel. I think the word cute best describes her, just in every sense of the word. Even on her character, a New Girl, she's that way. But I'm thinking back to the Zooey Deschanel in the band She and Him, which is a great little band. If you're interested, maybe we could play a little bit to the close out the show today. But I'm thinking of her in that movie Elf, and just she's cute as a button. She sings. She's really funny. I've met her on two occasions for wine events. She's also really sweet.
So she's might be an obtainable one on your list.
She does, and she lives in Los Angeles, California, and she was born in 1980. In fact, she just celebrated a birthday, so happy birthday, Zooey.
Do you need a towel or a moment?
I need something.
Okay.
But yeah, Zooey, and I also picked her because of her cool spelling of her name. Her name is spelled Zooey. Most people don't know it's Zooey Deschanel, which is,
I'm typing that out right now.
There you go. Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah, no, I like her. She's in.
Oh, also 500 Days of Summer. Did you see that
yes,
one?
Yes, yes, yes. That was a really good movie with Robin from The Dark Knight. What's his name? God damn it. What's his name? The actor.
Joseph Gordon
Levitt. Yeah, Joseph Gordon Levitt. Yeah, yeah, him. That was a good movie. My daughter liked that movie too. She's 14 and emotional. So anyway, back to my list. Now this week, this one I've had a crush on for a while. She came out into the world kind of at the same age. I want to say she's close to my age. She was cute then and just kept getting cuter and still looks the same. And she doesn't look like she's aging. She is, however, married to some guy that probably will never let go of her, which is smart. But I'm going to put Mia Kunis on my list.
Oh,
or Kunis or Mila or however you want to pronounce
Kunis.
It.
I was wondering when she would make an appearance on our list. I kind of held off picking her, and I really shouldn't have because now you've got her on your list.
That 70s show, she came out. She was cute. Like I want to say we're close to the same age, so that's probably why I connected with her when she first came out. But she also now she's like my hero because she has those – is it Jim Beam commercials? With the barrels and the whiskey?
Yes, the Angel Share commercials.
Yeah, like, oh my God, win-win. I'm in love. And of course, if you just Google her name, she's been in For Him and all those other magazines that are I don't know how you want to put it, but she's wearing very little clothing, and I love it. So I'm going to add Mia Kunis to my list.
Oh, that's a pretty good pick, right. And I think that about wraps it up for this week.
It does. You can follow me on Twitter, Chris_Donovan, or you can go to altmixedup.com. That's my alternative rock countdown show that I do every week on dirtyradio.fm, or you can get the Dirty Radio app. You can listen to the show up there, and you can find our Facebook page at that site and like it if you would.
And my youngest daughter, Josephine, would you like to say anything?
No.
No? Okay.
She says no. She's a liar.
She said no.
She's a liar.
All right, well, on Liar. Behalf of Josephine and Audrey, I say goodbye to Sinatra's Rat Pack on Twitter, and have a good week, everybody.
No, don't you want to say something about your book?
No, not really.
Okay.
Not this week.
Well, there you go.
I don't want anyone. Don't even look it up. Don't even look up my name.
Don't look up Eric Leckie or at Sinatra's Rat Pack. It would just be a waste of time.
It would be a waste of time. All right, everybody. Well, thank you. We really should
be better, at this sometimes. We suck.
Have a good week, everybody.
Catch you later.
Judy was boring.
Hello.
Then Judy discovered Chumbacasino.com.
It's my little escape.
Now Judy's the life of the party.
Oh, baby, mama's bringing home the bacon.
Whoa, take it easy, Judy. The Chumba life is for everybody. So go to Chumbacasino.com and play over 100 casino-style games. Join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes. Chumbacasino.com. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18+ terms and conditions apply. See website for details.